Our next speaker is a true citizen of the world. She was born in England, grew up in Brazil, studied at Stanford at the United States, and is now Senior Vice President at Booking.com. We are very pleased and honored to welcome Maria Rocha Barros. Hello, Maria. How are you?
Hi, Sylvain. How are you doing?
Fine, thank you. Thank you very much for taking the time. As I mentioned, you lived in many different places all around the globe. Can you tell us a little bit about your personal journey, what motivated you, what maybe has guided you in your education and also in your career?
That's a very philosophical question, but I like it. I think I would say two things that has driven me. I think the first one is to work internationally. And that started actually when I did the travel. When I was 11 years old, I went to an international camp in Thailand with people from all over the world. And at that time, I was very shy. And that actually changed my life. That camp made me meet people from all over the world and took me out of my comfort zone. So after that, I felt I really wanted to spread and go abroad. And I'm 40 years old. I have spent 20 years in Brazil and 20 years in six other countries. So that has driven me a lot. The other thing I would say, to study law, I really liked policy, how regulation can help the companies thrive. So I first started in capital markets. Then I got a more general role as general counsel of AB InBev first, a beer company. I used to call myself a beer lawyer. And now at Booking.com, which for me is fantastic because it's really linked to my passion.
You mentioned getting out of your comfort zone. How important was it? What role did it play in your success story?
Life is not just about successes. It's also about mistakes. So I think I always tried new things and I pushed myself to do that. And I want to say something here because I find so important to have these events like this one. And thank you very much for inviting me. And something was very important for me was having role models. And one of the role models was my mother. She's a psychoanalyst. She always had a career, but she was always there when I needed her. Even if it was like a dance event on a Wednesday at 3 p.m., she would make it work. And I can only hope that I can do the same to my daughter, Julia, who was born this year on International Women's Day, actually. And in career-wise, a lady called Sabina Chalmers, who now is General Counsel of British Telecom, she really supported me and took me out of my comfort zone, whether I liked it or not. One of the things she did was move me from a position that I was managing two people to then managing 85 as General Counsel of Europe and Middle East for AB InBev. So that was something, it was not always by design. It was also people believing in me and pushing me.
You are currently holding two very important positions at Booking.com, Senior Vice President, but also Chief Legal Officer. Can you tell us a little bit about your role and your mission at Booking.com?
Sure. So I lead the legal, compliance, and public affairs team of the company. And as you mentioned, I'm also part of the management board, so I report directly to the CEO of Booking Holdings and Booking.com. I would say the way I like to think about my role is that we operate in an extremely interesting industry that's the intersection of tech and travel. And on the tech side, I think there's a lot going on. It's an industry that's becoming more regulated, and we welcome that. We just want to make sure it's smart regulation. And being on my role gives me the chance to help shaping that. And I really believe that the next couple of years will form the basis for probably the next 10 and 20. And on the travel side, the mission of Booking is to make it easier for everyone to experience the world. And I really believe in that travel can help people become more open-minded, curious, and flexible, which is very needed. I also lead an international team of around 90 people and 90 and growing, of around 25 nationalities. And as I mentioned before, that's something that I love doing. And not just that diversity of countries, but also of perspectives, of backgrounds. So we have people that worked in startups, people that worked in very mature companies. And I think this will really help Booking in the next stage of its development. And the last point is that I truly believe in the legal department as a force for good within the company, ensuring the company grows in a business and ethical way. And that gives me a lot of energy every day.
Mm-hmm. I see. You started your job at booking.com in 2019, right?
Yes.
Back when nobody knew about a certain virus that would shake the world. Now, you mentioned the slogan of booking.com, which is making it easier for everyone to experience the world. Now, unfortunately, it has become much harder for everyone to experience the world. What have been the biggest obstacles and challenges for you personally, but also for the company booking.com during these last 18 months?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, of course, it hasn't been easy. And I'm happy to talk about many of the learnings from this moment. But I would say that travel will be back. You know, we are very optimistic and the industry is resilient. And one of the things that we are working on is building what we call the connected trip. So not just about accommodations, but transportation, attractions, like a holistic view of the trip. And we continue to do that. That hasn't changed. Of course, the crisis distracted us, and that's normal. And again, I can talk a little bit about these learnings. But the challenge has been to navigate the company throughout this very difficult moment. It's very, you know, and things are getting better in some places, but of course the COVID is not over. And more specifically about my area, I think one of the challenges is how fragmented regulation is and continues to be around the world, from consumer law to data protection. It's very different. And when you have a global product, that can be a challenge. And we can only imagine if that's a challenge for us, how it is for a startup in Europe.
Mm-hmm. That fragmentation of legal structure, is that also a topic for you as a chief legal officer?
Absolutely. You know, it's trying to harmonize what you're going to do when you have regulations from different countries that are not always consistent with each other, or even of different areas that are not consistent with each other. Mm-hmm. So you need to go work with governments and explain your position, but also sometimes make, you know, judgment calls of what you're going to do. It's just the nature of how it is. But that's why it's important to have a diverse team that understands legal systems in different places that can help us make those decisions.
Mm-hmm. A time of challenges can also be a time of opportunity, of course. When you think of learnings from that difficult time, both personal and professional, is there anything that comes to your mind? Is there anything that strikes out to you?
Yes, absolutely. I would put this in the kind of three buckets. From an industry perspective, I think one of the things we learned is how the importance of flexibility for customers, you know, refundable rates, insurance. The other thing, which I think is a positive development, is more focus on sustainability. Also, how can we play a role in helping customers make sustainable choices when they travel? And earlier this week, we launched a badge that is on sustainable travel. So that was a good learning, and I think an effect from the crisis. Not that we were not doing anything, but you see that things get accelerated. During the crisis, I had a few learnings that I would like to mention. One was as a leader and as a manager of a team. One is the importance of dividing your team. And what do I mean by that is between the people that are dealing with the issues from the crisis. In our case, refunding the customers was one of the big issues that we needed help managing. And the other piece is taking care of the day-to-day. And what I learned is that you cannot have your teams working in both, because then both get distracted. So it's very important to do that split, but at the same time, recognize the efforts of both teams, because it's easy to say, this team has worked on the crisis, has helped us throughout the crisis, and forget about all the people that were working on the day-to-day. Mm-hmm. So that was one of the learnings. The other one is when you're in a crisis, you have to make decisions very quickly, and you're going to make mistakes. There's no way around it. So it's very important to give that psychological safety to your teams and constantly tell them that it's okay to make mistakes and that mistakes will happen. And also be open about the mistakes yourself, that you make yourself. And also communicating a lot. You know, that was one of the things that I think many companies have done. I watched some of the other talks that you had. I think a lot of people have talked about weekly communications. And I think that that is a good thing. Some of the mistakes and challenges I made was, for example, to underestimate how it was hard to start during a pandemic. So I had people in my team starting that hadn't been to a booking.com office. And I knew, I tried to help them, but I don't think I did enough. The other thing is during a crisis, I think it's so easy for you to get stuck in your day-to-day and not spend enough time thinking about the world after. And at times that definitely happened to me. And the third thing I would say is have the courage to cancel projects, because if you have so much stuff to do, and also there's a lot of pressure financially, et cetera, on the company, you have to make some tough choices. And I would say, as an individual, I think it also is connected to that. You have to prioritize, but also you have to keep balance. And one of the things that I tried to do was every week to think about if I strike the right balance between short and term and long term, and also between family and everything that I had to do there, and my job and health, you know, working out and that sort of thing, to keep me honest. Because again, I think it's also very easy that you get so sucked in that you're not able to do anything else. So these are my main learnings. I could talk hours about this.
Mm-hmm. I see. We only have time for one last question, unfortunately. But some of the themes that are important to you and that are also part of corporate culture at Booking.com are themes like sustainability, as you already mentioned, inclusion, diversity. Can you tell us a little bit about what these themes mean to you personally and how they play a part in your daily work?
Yeah, I think the first thing is, yeah, I believe in diversity, that it drives innovation and better quality decisions. So I think in the interest of time, I will focus on the things that I try to do on a day-to-day basis. I think there's a lot of things that companies can do, like, you know, unconscious bias training, monitor payment gaps and that sort of thing. But I also try to do in my day to day is to coach and help women speak up, for example. You know, I think it's easy. It happens on average, unfortunately, that sometimes women can be more quiet and less present. And if I see that happening, I try to give them feedback. And I think it's so important to, especially different cultures are less comfortable with feedback. And I think it's very important to really have those uncomfortable conversations, of course, in the best possible way to help women. And the other thing is I went on maternity leave. So I had a lot of learnings about before, during and after maternity leave. So I try to do roundtables and also just mentoring and talking one-to-one with women about some of my learnings and some of my mistakes, so that when they go on maternity leave, they can prevent that from happening. And lastly, I think it's also supporting men as well during parental leave and also during kids' time. You know, 6 p.m., you want to have a call. You have to be careful with both men and women. I think that's the only way to normalize. But again, this is a very broad topic, so I could speak many different things, but that's what I would like to highlight now.
Maria, thank you very much for your time. Thank you for your insights and your ideas. Stay healthy.
Thanks, you
bye
too.
Bye.